So, good morning and Ramadan Kareem, and welcome to a workshop on the ethics of pain. A special welcome to our guests from abroad. It's good to have you with us, some of you to have you with us again, some of you for the first time at least here. My name is Shai Levy, and I am the director of the Edmond J. Safra Center for Ethics here at Tel Aviv University. Before we begin, allow me to say a few words about the motivation that has brought about this workshop. You can see quite an intimate workshop that's meant to produce a lot of good, I hope, good discussions. Our point of departure for the discussion of the ethics of pain is a very common assumption, or perhaps better, a thesis concerning pain. Let me name this thesis the secularization of pain. Under this thesis, there is no modern theodicy of pain. Pain in our times has become synonymous with the self-evident evil, and it has become a self-evident evil because it has lost its meaning, our ability to attribute meaning to pain and suffering. Previous generations, as well as non-Western civilizations, so the thesis goes, had a plethora of ways to make sense of pain and bear pain with dignity or resignation or even shame, rather than flee from the experience. From cradle to grave, from the labor of birth to the pangs of death, pain accompanied humanity and carried with it sense, not only sensitivity. Pain was a test, a punishment, it had expiatory power, or was simply a mark of human finitude. Pain had a necessity to it that made pain also more tolerable, because only the unnecessary can be truly intolerable. Today, according to the prevailing secularization of pain thesis, suffering makes little sense. It has become an evil, at times a necessary evil, but always an evil. For us moderns, our only way to make sense of pain is to eradicate it. From pain-killing medication through medical anesthesia, end-of-life palliative relief, we seek new ways to avoid experiencing pain. Even within the medical domain, pain has lost its meaning as a sign and warning and has transformed from a symptom to a syndrome. And today, pain clinics seek to manage pain independently from medical etiology. The participants in this workshop, you and us, have been asked to revisit this prevailing thesis. Some, and I had the opportunity to read most of the papers, some have sought to challenge the thesis, others have offered further and deeper insight to its logic. Has pain truly become a self-evident evil in modern societies? Do we no longer valorize, in certain contexts, suffering and sacrifice? Or think of the maxim, no pain, no gain, which is true not only in sports, but also in therapy and psychological therapy. Are there modern practices of pain beyond the eradication of pain that turn pain into an ethics, perhaps an aesthetics? And what can we say about the history of pain? Is it true that in previous societies, in the history of the West, pain was only valorized and glorified and made sense? We'll be able to explore some of this through the history and cultural history and art history of these questions. One way to rethink our approach to the ethics of pain is to return to foundational questions about the nature of pain. After all, there can be no serious discussion of the ethics of pain without discussing what pain is. In fact, the question of the nature of pain cannot be separated from the question of the ethics of pain. Understanding pain scientifically, medically, is not just an objective description, it is part of an ethics. The elusive nature of the experience of pain and its paradoxes, about which we will we'll soon hear, the tension between the phenomenological experience of pain and the science of pain are all questions that will be with us in the coming 2 days. Let me conclude these brief remarks with a reflection on the title of the workshop, The Ethics of Pain. It has a double meaning. Grammatically, ethics of pain, ethics can be understood either as a nominative or as a genitive. On the one hand, we seek to think ethically about pain. On the other hand, we may wish to think of how central pain has become to our ethical understanding. Are there ways today of thinking the ethical beyond the Benthamite calculus of pain? Are there ways of thinking of pain beyond its medicalization? So these are opening remarks, and let me just say that this conference is hosted at the Edmond J. Safra Center for Ethics. The center has put itself to itself the task of asking questions in the meeting point of science, ethics, and democracy, and trying to ask foundational questions of ethics. Pain has been on our agenda this year. Earlier this year, Professor Jose Brunner here organized in collaboration with the center and in collaboration with the Goethe University in Frankfurt, another conference on different aspects of pain, and I'm happy that this in many ways is a continuation of that discussion. I would also like to thank the co-organizers, one of whom you'll meet later, Lina Salaime, and also the people in the center that have been, as always, so helpful in making this happen. First and foremost, Dr. Chagai Boaz, sitting here, and also our secretary, whom some of you may have already met, our visitors, I mean, Sharon Verit Shekel. I think that before, if we have maybe just a few more minutes, it might be helpful, since we're not a very large group, maybe we go around and people just briefly introduce themselves. Does that sound good?
So. Sure. So my name is Drew Leader from Loyola University, Maryland, Baltimore in the United States. Thank you.
Nehama Verbin from Tel Aviv University, the Department of Philosophy and the Religious Studies
Department.
Can you speak a bit louder?
Physician, medical faculty.
My area is bioethics, you can call it.
Raina Bremer from Istanbul University, Istanbul Medical Faculty, and Department for the History of Medicine and Ethics.
I'm Hazan, social anthropologist from the University of Edmund, Safra Center.
Hassan Ali, I'm physician and head of the pain and palliative care department at Dublin Center and Valence and Hospital.
Marcus Franzi, I'm an associate professor at the University of Versailles in France and visiting fellow here this term.
I'm Dana Zahin, I'm a postdoctoral research fellow here at the Safra Center.
Ian McGonigal, visiting from Harvard University, currently a fellow at the Safra Center, working on social studies of science.
Welcome on board. What's your name?
Daniel Nazer.
Pleasure.
Okay. I'm Elise Ferdo from the Philosophy Department.
Noam Yuval, I'm a postdoctoral fellow with the
Guy Boaz from the Safra Center.
Neil Shacha from the Department of Literature and German Studies.
My name is Yaacov, Yadgar. I'm from Berlin University, and I'm going to chair the first. So should we start?
I think we should.
So, I, So good morning. The structure of the first presentation would be you have two speakers and two commentators, one each. So we'll have a paper and a comment, and then another paper and another comment. And then we'll open the...
We'll do paper, comment, and discussion.
Oh, okay.
Paper, comment, and discussion.
So, fair enough. And we have about 20-25 minutes for the paper and about 10-15 minutes for the comment, which means 25 and 15, right? So.
Maybe 20 and 10, I hope, but we'll see.
Optimism is a good virtue. So let me just present our speaker and commentator at the first round. Professor Bruce Leader, who has already presented himself, he is an MD and a PhD from the Department of Philosophy at Loyola University in Maryland. He is the author of some 6 books, including The Absent Body and his forthcoming book, The Distressed Body, Rethinking Illness, Incarceration, and Healing, both at the University of Chicago Press. His work has centered on the philosophy of medicine, writing with and about prisoners, and more popular books on spirituality and everyday life, using both Asian and Western traditions as inspiration. His commentator, Dr. Nehama Verbin, is senior lecturer at the philosophy department here at Tel Aviv University and the head of the religious studies program. She is the author of Divinely Abused, a philosophical perspective on Job and his kin, published by Continuum at 2010, and of numerous articles on faith, doubt, and their relation to one another, on the problem of evil, and on various topics at the intersection between philosophy of religion and ethics. She is currently working on a manuscript on divine providence in the works of Maimonides, Kierkegaard, and Simon Weil. Simon.
Thank you. So, thank you, first of all, very much to our hosts at the center, and for all the wonderful people assembled around the room. Can you hear me okay? Okay, there's a mic here, I'm not sure if it's working, and hopefully I won't need it. So I'm going to briefly start things off with a phenomenological analysis of pain. I'm putting on my hat as a philosopher, though as was mentioned, I also have an MD. And focusing on how pain is a lot more than just an aversive sensation, but especially chronic pain is filled with various modes of ambiguity and paradox and tensions and pressures and oscillations. And a general term I would give for that is to say that pain has a liminal character. I'm not very good at pronouncing L's, even though my name is Leader, but I hope you understood liminal, a term borrowed from anthropological literature, and it refers to that which is not contained by or defined by ordinary situations and structures, but inhabits a kind of in-between state, a nether region characterized by ambiguity, paradox, a confusion of customary characters. And I'm going to very quickly discuss 9 different ways in which I believe that's operative in pain. I am attentive to the 20-minute limit, so we're going to do like 2 minutes a category. I know some of you have read the papers in advance and some of you may have not, but I'll try to go through it quickly. So I'll highlight each in turn. Sensation and interpretation. Let's start with the question, what is pain? And the initial answer seems to be clear. Maybe you point to the region in your body and you say, this is pain. Here, I'm feeling it right on my side, a little bit below my rib cage. And it doesn't seem to have the referential structure that other sensory and intentional states like hearing and sight have. Even emotional, physiological states like hunger and fear always seem to be hunger for something or fear of something. And as Elaine Scarry said in her very influential book, The Body and Pain, quote, pain is not of or for anything, it is itself alone. This objectlessness, the complete absence of referential content, almost prevents it from being rendered into language. And so we become almost reduced to grunts and groans. And though I think this is somewhat true phenomenologically, we've probably had that experience of pain kind of reducing our world and cutting off our intentional relationships. I would say, at least in my own experience, pain retains a referential character. It's a pain of something. And I'm going to keep referring, as a continuing example, to my own experience of chronic pain, where I developed a kind of strange nerve pain. I'm going to try to demonstrate it. literally just above the medial malleolus, or ankle bone, on my left side. The whole thing was an oval of about this size, but it was a pain that was almost always with me, fluctuating, made it difficult to walk, you know, to travel, to engage in activities of everyday life. But it was very difficult to get a diagnosis of it. I would see vascular surgeons and neurologists and a pain specialist and acupuncture, and they would tell me different stories about what my pain was of. And each time I had a new diagnosis, the sensed pain itself changed in quality, intensity, effective content. So, for example, a first diagnosis was that I had a possible stress fracture. And as soon as I heard that, my pain started feeling very sharp and intense, the pain of a broken bone. And then I was told it might have been inflammation, and suddenly the area felt very warm and tender. Varicose veins was a possible diagnosis. My legs started feeling kind of heavy and swollen. The ultimate diagnosis was, though, that I had some kind of a peripheral neuropathy, some kind of nerve damage. And then the pain started foregrounding kind of sharp and burning sensations. And you could say, well, all of these were always a component of the pain. But really, based on what my understanding was of what the pain signified, the quality of the pain itself changed. And also whether it felt like it might be getting better or was intractable or might be getting worse. So anyway, in addition to having the immediacy of sensation, pain also has this very complex mediacy of referentiality, interpretation, and practical response. This also leads to a second paradox, that between certainty and uncertainty. The way Elaine Scarry understands this is she says, pain cannot be denied by the person who is having it. It's kind of a philosophical example of the, you know, kind of the veridical, undeniable experience. However, pain cannot really be confirmed by other people. And so pain also enters the philosophical discourse as an example of skepticism. And once again, though I think she's right about this existential epistemological split between self and other, I also think that even for the experiencer of pain, there's a kind of radical uncertainty as to what's going on. For example, doctors would ask me the classic question, at least in the United States, on a scale of 1 to 10, how bad is your pain? And that proved to be a very difficult question to answer because, of course, my pain was fluctuating moment to moment, let alone over the course of a day. I've been told I have a very high pain tolerance, but I also think I can be a very big baby about pain. So deciding, is this a 3 or is this a 6? And what kind of clinical response will I get from saying each number, or how will that even affect insurance coverage? Made it very difficult to give it that kind of a designation. And even sometimes to say where the pain is, because sometimes it would be a surface pain, sometimes it would be deep, radiating, expanding, contracting. And, of course, the tricky thing in trying to dispense with this uncertainty is there's nowhere you can go for help. There's no diagnostic machine or no other person that can clarify for you whether you're in pain or how much pain you're in. Is this real? So we have this kind of uncanniness oscillating with this kind of certainty of being in pain. We might then ask the question, once again, kind of like, not just where is the pain, but when is the pain? And when I say when is the pain, I don't just mean according to calendar time. You know, what day did it start, or what time in the evening does it come on? Because sometimes you can designate that with great precision. But there's also the question of what the pain does to your sense of temporality. How does it change your sense of time? And one way to look at it is pain imprisons you in the here and now, in the present, inescapably. To use kind of Christian iconography, it's almost like a cross of suffering where you're caught right at that point of presence, somewhat inescapably, in my case, suffering shocks and spasms caused by my mysterious nerve injury. But the paradox is that not only are we caught in presence, but we're also kind of propelled away from it, because the pain is so aversive that we want to escape it in search of relief. We can't escape it to the past. I put it in perspective by looking at our life story or remembering comforting remembrances. But in my case, I tended to escape it into the future. You know, the day after tomorrow, I'm going to see the specialist. Maybe I'll try a new medication or therapeutic approach. Hopefully this pain will go away within 6 weeks or 2 months. So there's always the kind of being propelled outward in this projective way, in this case into the future. Another paradox of temporality, though, that I became very aware of in my own bout with chronic pain, I call it the never-changing and the ever-changing. You know, of course, chronic pain is pain. It comes from the Greek word chronos. It suggests that certain modes of suffering are really set off by the fact that they continue over the long passage of time and also just go on repetitively, kind of like Nietzsche's eternal recurrence. Over hours and days and months and years, this never-changing nightmare that you're caught with. But on the other hand, at least in my own experience, the pain is ever-changing, moment to moment. It depends on exercise or the passage of time, what time of day it is, if somebody even brushes up against my skin, if my mood changes, all of these change the quality and intensity of time, moment to moment and over the course of a day. So let me switch from the kind of temporality of time to kind of like of pain to the location of pain. Most classically, we ask the question, is pain located in the body? And at first that seems self-evidently true. You know, once again, I showed you, I'll show you again. Everybody likes to talk about their own pain. You know, it was right here. I could literally take out a marker before I went to see a physician and draw a circle around it so they understood the precise borders of it. But if you do something like Descartes' meditation, even on a low level, you can also realize, well, wait a second, this pain isn't just located over there in my body. It's located somewhere in my mind, somewhere in my consciousness. It's a qualia, to use contemporary analytic philosophical language. We're familiar with the IASP definition of pain as an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience. That's the Cartesian mind part. associated with actual or potential tissue damage, or described in such in terms of such damage. That's the kind of physical embodied part. So a lot of our definitions and practitioners try to kind of bridge that divide or give due acknowledgement to both of them. Let me go right to a little clinical material. Here's an interview by Byron Good with a young man, Brian, who is perhaps suffering from temporomandibular joint disorder, TMJ. That's at least one possible diagnosis. But I'm interested in his quote. He says, "Is it my body? Is it my thinking process that activates physical stresses? Or am I, or is it the other way around? In other words, is the body changing what's happening in my mind, or the mind changing what's happening in my body?" It's all that uncertainty, he says, that plagues him, the sufferer, this kind of oscillation or ambiguity of mind and body. And you might say, at least within my own phenomenological tradition, that this has a lot to do with kind of the Western metaphysical confusion, going back to Plato, intensified with Descartes, this whole notion of mind-body dualism, and we might prefer an alternative phenomenological sense of the lived body, where we understand that we don't just have bodies, we're not just disembodied souls carrying around a piece of meat that we're mysteriously connected to. But really, we are our bodies. You know, I'm talking to you, you're listening, we're sitting, our emotions, our passions, our movement, our sensation, even our cognition is mediated through the living body. Or as Merleau-Ponty says it, the body is our general medium for having a world. But even here, we have this kind of experiential dualism. Phenomenologically, would we say that pain is kind of in the lived body, in the self, or somehow other than the self? And I think, once again, it's kind of both. Certainly when you have pain, it reflects you back and reminds you how powerfully you are embodied. That's easy to forget when you're in health, you know, and you're just paying attention to the beauty of the city or the beauty of the waterfront. But suddenly when your leg starts hurting, your consciousness falls back, and you realize your own body and how much you are a body. But at the same time, you also kind of realize that you have a body. And this body, to use the terminology of Richard Zehnder, is kind of an alien presence, something uncanny that is opposing me, threatening me, and can even destroy me. Bacon said, pain is a harbinger of death. Even if you don't have a fatal or progressive illness, it kind of reminds you of your vulnerability and your mortality. One other paradox about kind of where to locate the pain. On the one hand, pain causes a collapse of the spatio-temporal framework. So you can say, you know, everything is focused right here. This is where my pain is. But on the other hand, at least in English, we use this phrase, not just kind of like I have a pain, but I am in pain, as if pain is this kind of globalizing thing. And in fact, it is. You know, our pain begins to radiate, it begins to take over our whole embodied experience. It even begins to flood the outward world that we feel intentionally connected to. So if I'm going for a walk on the beautiful path near my house, suddenly I'm aware of the rocks and the crevices I might stumble over, and it might cause an intensification of ankle pain. If I hear children crying in the distance, suddenly it sounds ominous. You know, their voices sound like shrieks. The beauty of the world around me begins to be a vaguely menacing or at least drained of color and warmth. So pain has this kind of world destructive capacity. It takes over that everywhere. And I want to conclude very quickly, hopefully very quickly, with talking a little bit about the kind of how and why of pain, including the treatment of pain. This paradox of, on the one hand, you know, in terms of how do I gain mastery over the pain, what do I do? Pain is that which is out of control, despite all our attempts at diagnosis and treatment and tests and medications and conventional medicine, alternative medicine, prayer, meditation. Pain keeps reasserting itself and really seems to have control over us. We see this, for example, in the word patient, a hospital patient, or try to be patient with your pain, coming from the Latin root pati, which means to suffer, but is also part of the English word passive, meaning we who are, you know, in this receptive position rather than the active and controlling position. However, you know, the paradoxical other side of this kind of liminal oscillation is that there are ways in which we have control of pain, and there are even ways in which having pain flips us into a position of what I call hyper-agency, meaning I become a decision maker. You know, when I get home, should I elevate my leg? How long can I remain sitting at the computer before I better stop? Can I accept an invitation to go to a conference 2 months from now? Can I even go to a movie tonight? I'm not sure how I'll feel. So when in pain, you have to make a lot of not only macro, but also micro decisions that when you're in good health, things that you don't even worry about as you glide through the world relatively stress-free. So once again, in control, but also continually out of control. And finally, kind of the why of pain, which for me is the last point, but for people in pain, it's often the first issue, kind of why did this happen? Why me? Why was I singled out? And of course, the answers are as diverse as there are different people and different types of conditions. But pain can be very destructive of meaning, and other people are going to speak about this during the conference. I just want to give an example from Stella Hoff, a biomedical researcher who suffers severe pain 4 years after a car accident, and she says, suffering isn't evil. I mean, suffering that has no meaning. Spoke about this from the very beginning. Suffering that brings nothing good with it. My spirit is hurt, wounded. There is no transcendence. I have found no creativity, no meaning in this entirely horrible experience. There is no God in it. It shatters all I took for granted and believed in. So in this case, it's almost an active force of secularization. And we see pain's destructiveness both in the sense that it can signify failure, punishment, and of course the word pain comes from the Latin word for punishment, poena. And a lot of chronic pain sufferers feel on some level, conscious or unconscious, that they've done something to deserve this, that this is a punishment. And that makes it very difficult to practice self-care and compassion and recovery when you feel that way. Also, pain is destructive, not only in that sense, but also just in the sense of the way it destroys any attempts at meaning. We heard Stella Hoff talk about how this is a suffering that has no meaning. I can find no reason, no purpose. But this is not only or always the case. Because I think we're also aware that pain is not only destructive, but pain is productive. And some people will speak about this. And once again, productive in two senses. It keeps coming after you, almost like a Zen koan, a provocative question. where all the solutions you propose are knocked down, but it leads you to go deeper and deeper. And in my case, I did feel like I arrived at certain insights and a realization of blessings, maybe a strengthening of character, a permission to slow down, to begin to transition into the wisdom years of later life, to experience the power of family and community and healthcare practitioners reaching out to help, to cultivate internal meditative and spiritual practices, to listen more closely to my body. I did all this good stuff because I had to, because the pain itself was provoking it. And I think we're aware that even when pain continues, there can still be healing in the etymological sense of wholeness and even holiness, where the pain on some level is resolved or dissolved. Not that it necessarily and physically goes away, but the capacity pain has that we've been discussing to bewilder, frustrate, disorient, the sufferer can diminish. But it's not an easy process because pain, as I've tried to suggest, triggers a series of experiential paradoxes that shock and destabilize your world. So thank you.
Thank you, Professor Leder.
Thank you.
Dr. Verbin, please.
My comments are directed at the first paradox, mostly. In his insightful paper, The Experiential Paradoxes of Pain, Professor Leder challenges the distinction between pain and suffering, pointing to the ways in which different interpretive perspectives transform the quality, intensity, meaning, and effective content of an experienced pain. He points to the totalizing effect of pain, which, although located in a specific bodily organ, may seem to spill over to the whole world, and argues that a full-scale phenomenology of pain leads us beyond the parameter of specific sensation. Professor Leder's phenomenology involves two distinct components. The first insists that we do not experience pain as a pure sensation, that our very experience of pain is already, at least sometimes, constituted by our understanding of its causes, expected duration, meaning, etc. The second challenges the distinction between pain and suffering. I believe that Professor Leder's phenomenological perspective on chronic pain cannot be disregarded in any serious attempt to gain insight into the nature of pain. His observations concerning the theory-laden nature of pain are enlightening and important. I fully endorse them. Thus, in what follows, I wish to explore the manner in which two interpretative religious frameworks shape the experience of pain that the believer undergoes. I shall focus on Maimonides and Kierkegaard. However, I shall also argue that it is because Professor Leder's observations concerning the theory-laden nature of pain are to be endorsed that we are to draw a distinction between pain and suffering, that pain, severe and prolonged too, need not cause, or be experienced as suffering. I begin with Maimonides. Pain from Maimonides has to do with matter, with the frailty of our body, which is subject to time, to change, to disease, and to death. Both the wise and the unwise are susceptible to the contingency of matter, to aging, injury, and death. The lives of both involve pain due to the matter from which they're constituted. The unwise, however, are more vulnerable to pain in its diverse forms. Being immersed in matter, the unwise indulge in practices that are harmful to the body. They eat and drink in excess. They consume harmful substances. They take unnecessary risks. They pursue inappropriate aims, the attainment of which involves a greater dependency on chance, and thus anxiety, sickness, pain, and sorrow.
although the prevalence of pain can be diminished by wisdom, it cannot be eliminated altogether. Suffering, however, can be completely done away with by wisdom, according to Maimonides. In his Guide of the Perplexed, he makes the following comments concerning Job's suffering. I'm quoting, "The most marvelous and extraordinary thing about this story is the fact that knowledge is not attributed in it to Job. He is not said to be a wise or a comprehending or an intelligent man. Only moral virtue and righteousness in action are ascribed to him. For if he had been wise, his situation would not have been obscure for him." Maimonides, end of quote. Maimonides seems to presuppose a distinction between pain, disease, and loss, on the one hand, and the suffering that they characteristically produce on the other. Job, according to Maimonides, did not suffer due to his loss of property and children, nor did he suffer due to his disease and pain. Job suffered due to his ignorance. I'm quoting, "The latter Job said all that he did say as long as he had no true knowledge and knew the deity only because of his acceptance of authority. But when he knew God with a certain knowledge, he admitted that true happiness, which is the knowledge of the deity, is guaranteed to all who know him, and that a human being cannot be troubled in it by any of all the misfortunes in question. While he had known God only through the traditional stories, and not by the way of speculation, Job had imagined that the things thought to be happiness, such as health, wealth, and children, are the ultimate goal. For this reason, he fell into such perplexity and said such things as he did." End of quote. The knowledge of the deity which eliminates suffering, however, is not to be understood in propositional terms for Maimonides, but rather in mystical, contemplative ones. The Maimonidean sage is not defined as a sage by possessing propositional knowledge about what God is or is not. Rather, he is constituted as a sage by arriving at a state of contemplation of the divine name, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. It is in that state of contemplation that he or she, as the case may be for Maimonides, realizes true happiness, even while experiencing pain. It is by means of one's intellect, however, that one ascends to such a happy state. The intellect has to rule the body and its impulses, to admit to the body only that which is indispensable to it. It has to cleanse itself from the false images of the divine that it tends to produce. It has to exchange flawed concepts and metaphors with slightly less flawed ones, and ultimately with no concepts and metaphors at all. Only then can it reach a state of contemplation of the divine name that is uninterrupted by matter and its contingency. Maimonides describes the happy life of the sage who reaches such a state as being lived on two parallel planes. I'm quoting, "And there may be a human individual who achieves a state in which he talks with people and is occupied with his bodily necessities, while his intellect is wholly turned toward him, may he be exalted, so that in his heart he is always in his presence, may he be exalted, while outwardly he is with people. Such a sage, being always in God's presence, fully transcends his body. His joy, therefore, in and of itself is uninterrupted by his bodily condition. He is therefore protected from every type of harm. Nothing and no one can undo him. Nothing and no one can cause him terror and distress and separate him from God. He is happy in the pleasure of his passionate, loving, intellectual, and yet mystical contemplation of God. Suffering, for Maimonides, is therefore a symptom of a bad life. Suffering is defeated, it is abolished by wisdom, by knowledge. Pain and loss, however, remain." I now turn to Kierkegaard. Kierkegaard draws the conceptual map differently. He distinguishes between pain experienced as something to be endured, something forced upon one to suffer passively. In these circumstances, pain and suffering are indistinguishable. They are, quote, a suffering, a succumbing to the external circumstance. Other types of pain that one may experience, however, are not characterized by passivity. They are not, properly speaking, a suffering, although they may begin as suffering. They are what he calls, I'm quoting, a self-activity, an act. They are characterized by a consciousness which breaks with immediacy, as he puts it, which breaks with the world. When one chooses the eternal over and against the temporal, in the constitutive dilemma between God and the world that we all face, according to Kierkegaard, such a self-activity to one's pain and loss is realized. It is realized by what he calls the thought of faith. We all must choose either God or the world, according to Kierkegaard. There is no middle way. He states, for example, the human being must choose. The struggle is terrible. The struggle in a person's inner being between God and the world. What should a person choose? He should choose God's kingdom and his righteousness. For this, he should give up everything. And elsewhere, love of God is hatred of the world, and love of the world is hatred of God. Therefore, this is the colossal point of contention, either love or hate. Therefore, this is the place where the most terrible struggle carried on in the world must be fought. And where is this place? In a person's being. Choosing God transforms the pain from passive suffering into active sorrow. In so doing, the possibility of consolation, of joy, enters in. The rejected world, however, does not disappear. The value of one's body, of one's physical welfare, persists. It is due to the significance of the temporal, of the world, of the body, that Kierkegaard describes the commitment to give it up as a sacrifice. If the world were perceived as insignificant, rejecting it, hating it, giving it up, would have amounted to nothing, least of all to a sacrifice. Thus, unlike the Maimonidean sage who transcends the world, the Kierkegaardian knight of faith remains within the world and therefore torn by his joint residency in both the world and in eternity. His rejection of the world is a sacrifice that presupposes the world's significance. It involves not merely pain and loss, but also sorrow, although it does not involve suffering. Although the life of faith is replete with pain, loss, and sorrow, although Kierkegaard insists that faith does not reduce pain and sorrow, but rather, on the contrary, enhances them, faith also brings joy into sorrow, and in so doing defeats it. Joy has the final word. The defeat of sorrow is not quantitative, but qualitative. It does not involve a dissolution of sorrow into pain, nor necessarily a subjective alteration in its felt intensity. I'm quoting. In a certain sense, the burden remains the same, since the burden is the suffering, the heavy suffering, and yet the burden becomes light. A person's lot here on earth has not become different from before because Christianity entered into the world. A Christian can come to suffer exactly the same as was suffered before. Yet, the heavy burden becomes light for a Christian. The one and the same burden is heavy and yet light. The lightness of the burden is not to be understood in quantitative terms. The sufferer does not suffer less. The joy that defeats suffering, that renders it light, that outweighs it, is incommensurate with it. It belongs to a different order of things. I'm quoting. Gold has a special value that makes it meaningless to weigh gold and feathers together. So it is also here with the two stated magnitudes. The distinction is not between happiness and suffering, but between eternal happiness and temporal suffering. The relation is this misrelation, and that it is a misrelation shows up most clearly in this, that the relation between temporal bliss and eternal happiness is the same misrelation. Moreover, I'm quoting, temporal suffering and eternal happiness are not only heterogeneous in the essential sense, as golden feathers are, but are heterogeneous in the infinitely essential sense. The slightest part of the happiness of eternity weighs infinitely more than the longest earthly suffering, even when the temporal suffering is the heaviest, even when it lasts a lifetime. Eternal happiness still has the overweight. Since suffering and joy are in the infinitely essential sense heterogeneous when compared to one another, the thought of faith does not undo the sorrow. It neither abolishes it nor diminishes it. Faith alters it completely while leaving everything in place. It brings in a new dimension into it, a new narrative, a new way of seeing, a new meaning. The ordeal is not seen solely as a horror, it is also seen under the category of a blessing. Various concepts come to play a role within that new perspective, within the new narrative: God, love, blessedness, eternity, happiness, and joy. The perspective of faith, however, does not annul the horror. Both the horror and the blessing are real for Kierkegaard. I'm quoting, faith is the conviction, the blessed conviction, which is in fear and trembling. When faith is seen from its one side, the heavenly, only the reflection of eternal salvation is seen in it. But seen from its other side, the merely human side, one sees sheer fear and trembling. Faith for Kierkegaard involves both the horror and the blessing. Although neither can be done away with, although neither can be ignored, joy has the final word. I'm quoting, existence is blessedly secured with the help of eternity. In every danger, there is a hidden trapdoor to ascent. Just when a person is closest to despairing, there is a place to step on, and everything changes infinitely. Kierkegaard refers to the transformative moment of faith, to the joy that defeats sorrow, as a miracle. I'm quoting, in the external sense, there certainly is no change. The sufferer remains on the spot, in his condition. And yet, there is the change, the wondrous change, the miracle of faith. We have thus seen the manners in which two religious frameworks shape the experience of pain and make use of the distinction between pain and suffering. Whether chronic pain is a reductio ad absurdum of these religious frameworks is a question that I shall not presume to engage with in this context. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So we now open the court for a comment and discussion. Yes, please.
So the paradoxes of pain that you discuss, they seem to be experiential paradoxes that are not just associated with pain. You could say these more generally are paradoxes manifest in embodiment.
Speaking of the body, I just arrived in Israel from the United States, and my body is at 3 a.m. in the morning, and therefore my mind is not, you know, working at full speed. But I'm writing a piece at the moment on breathing, for a new phenomenological volume on the breath, which of course is a hugely important theme and embodiment that's been neglected. And I find myself coming back to this kind of sense of a paradoxical framework, the ambiguity, which is expressed, let's say, in the breath between the oscillation of the once again, as you say, it does seem to me that this paradoxical nature of embodiment is a theme in neuropathy, but it's a theme in everyday life. And so I wonder with pain if it doesn't, in certain ways, intensify them, you know, kind of sharpen the sense of oscillation and opposition. Yeah. And
excuse me, could you keep...
Okay.
That's it around when you talk.
Okay. But I have a feeling like it does introduce certain paradoxical dimensions, let's say the present and the projective, the sense of both being pulled back intensely into an awareness of embodiment, you know, in my case, the ankle pain, but also being intensely thrown out, like trying to escape it, trying to forget it, trying to cure it, experiencing the body as a force of threat and opposition. It seems to me, while there might be the latent possibility of that present always in your everyday life, but there is a way in which pain both brings it to the fore and is characterized by the intensity of that dialectic. So it feels to me like what is put on the board is not simply and only kind of a profile of everyday embodied life, but does have some, you know, special characteristics that signal this off as a different and kind of dissonant state. But that's a really provocative question. We'd all have to really think that through.
So, Drew, thank you for, can you hear? It should work. Let's see if it works.
You're only connected.
A long day. So, Drew, thank you for this presentation, which is a wonderful presentation as an opening because it puts a lot of questions on the table. And also, thank you, Hami, for making this kind of abstract, phenomenological, in that sense, concrete, but also ahistorical in a certain context. But I was wondering about these paradoxes, and they don't seem to me to be the same kind of paradoxes. And so I would distinguish, maybe you have a different way of distinguishing between them, but I would distinguish between three different kinds of paradoxes. One is a paradox that you want to say, it's neither the two, it's really something, it's a third. And the third is not in the paradox, but we want to look for it elsewhere. So for example, you came to say something close to that when you were talking about the mind and the body. You're saying there's a dualism, but we really need to get over the dualism. It's not the mind, nor is it the body. We need a third conception of the self, or that would be, you know, that we'd need to develop. Other times, it seems to me that you were taking sides in this paradox, that it wasn't a third, but rather it was one of the two, and that you were hinting that we should think about it more this way rather than this way, or at least this is how I heard it. So, for example, sensation and interpretation. The medical establishment tells us it's about sensation, but really, it can't be about sensation. It's really about interpretation and the different ways in which we interpret and make sense of the sensations. A third option, which is kind of more complicated in my mind, is the certainty uncertainty. Because if we go to the medical diagnosis, it would seem that medicine as science is about certainty and that this is pointing somehow to uncertainty. But in fact, the phenomenology is often that of certainty, whereas doctors now realize that there's, you know, you really don't know where it is, where it's coming from. And so there's a certain phenomenology of certainty that also needs to be taken into account. And here, I don't think you're taking sides, but here I think that there is kind of a reversal between the science of phenomenology. Anyways, a different kind of relationship between the science of the phenomenology than in the other some of the other paradoxes. So I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about that, but I think you need this. And
yeah, I think that's very very insightful and very helpful. The notion that these have kind of different characters, and maybe I'm sort of playing one side of the field more than the other, or abandoning the field altogether for a different way of looking at it. So I don't have that much to say. I'll just comment, let's say, on the mind-body. There is a way, obviously, in which I find myself rejecting kind of Cartesian-style substantial dualism as a way of understanding experience or as a way of schematizing medical practice. And it doesn't seem to me a very helpful way to look at pain to get stuck in this kind of dualism or a monism that emphasizes one to the exclusion of the other. But I do think pain is a very interesting experience in that it provokes a kind of experiential dualism, so that when we look at someone like Descartes, we would say, well, they're not simply being misled by a kind of pre-commitment to a metaphysical foundation based in theology, but actually they're having, when people have certain experiences like pain, where you feel your own body opposing your will, clouding your consciousness, and you get a sense of the self as somehow in opposition to the body, you split, you fracture. And so the experience itself is provocative of dualism on the everyday level, even though at the same time, dualism doesn't provide an ultimately satisfactory way of understanding or treating what you're experiencing. So I'm not disagreeing with what you're saying. But I do think one could take these paradoxes and really explore in greater depth kind of the meaning and the response personally, but also philosophically. Should we pass this down?
So I received this in the mail today, the other day, and I thought it'd be very interesting to help me with some of my clinical practice, but I'm not sure. Look, my problem is that we've got these patients that come and tell me that they've got pain, and I treat them and I give them lots of morphine and even more cannabis, but I don't know how to tell the difference if they've got physical pain or they're just anxious, fearful, existentially distressed. And they use the drugs, particularly cannabis today. I'm one of the biggest suppliers in the Tel Aviv area. And I can't tell the difference. And so I was hoping to find answers here. And secondly, we're trying to do a study now. And I don't know how to make the study to distinguish the patients that are taking, in this case, cannabis for physical pain or for psychological and spiritual relief. And you try and talk to them, and it's about as confusing to me as some of the discussion today. They don't understand that. You cannot talk to them and say, I don't think it's pain, I think you've got psychological and spiritual distress.
Why is it the difference important? Why do
you care to because filling them up with opioids for emotional and psychological distress is no good. No good. Giving them lots of cannabis for this, according to the guidelines from the Ministry of Health, we're not meant to. It might be in the future permissible and a good idea to give Lockhart. I don't know. But I find it very difficult to distinguish the two. And, you know, at the end of the day, maybe it doesn't matter. But I think we give too much opiates, and the cannabis, look, in most of the chronic pain departments in the Tel Aviv area, they've stopped giving cannabis. Ichilov, Tel Shomer, And certainly at our hospital, Beilinson, the chronic pain departments now refuse to deal with cannabis because a large people come to get it for psychological, spiritual, existential relief, which is maybe fine, but within the medical framework currently, that's unfine. It's not good. So I was hoping for some answers.
I'll have a quick comment to the other people in the room because we were having a discussion like this on the taxi coming here, so I know there are other people, including physicians, who deal with this. My only quick comment is there is a sort of clinical epistemological issue of people who are essentially deceiving the physician, giving a pretended account in order to get access to cannabis or opioids, and in a way that falls maybe beyond the bounds of what we're discussing here. That's almost more a detective question, but the one thing I would say is it does seem like operative in your mind and maybe operative within the medical system is this notion of a fairly strict mind-body dualism. Is there genuine pain in the body, in which case I'm empowered to prescribe these drugs, or is it all in their mind, in which case I shouldn't be, or it's illegal to, or I'm doing them a disservice? And I think we are saying that this whole distinction between mind and body is problematic. It may not correspond to the way in which we genuinely live and experience. And so there might be times when one doesn't need to worry about it. It could be existentially derived, but they are experiencing it as real physical pain. But I wonder if anyone else has a comment on this.
On this point, or?
Yeah. Thank you. So I'll just continue the discussion, and my question is actually to both of you, and it regards the problem of mental suffering or psychological suffering. So you're speaking about the question whether our pain is here or there, so mind or body. And Chami, you were talking about the separation, right? So there is the pain, and there is my judgment of pain as suffering, right? And then the sage can somehow be detached from this, from the second part. But this kind of fork, right, is in both discussions regards physical pain. And continuing on the previous question, I'd like to ask you to say a few words about mental or psychological pain / suffering. Is this possibility of separation, is there a possibility of separation there too? So could we say that, I would use mind here, right? But somehow my psyche has a pain and a suffering, or can I judge my mental pain in this or that way? Is it possible to separate at all?
It's a very interesting question to apply to Maimonides, actually, more so than to Kierkegaard. The Stoics have a notion of first movements. So, for example, the Stoic sage, when he sees a lion, he can have quick heartbeats. Is he afraid? No, he's not afraid because the judgment that he's facing something dangerous is lacking, or something that can cause him damage is lacking. So can the distinction be applied to the loss of a loved one? That the first movement is, tears flowing out of your eyes, but since the judgment is lacking, then there is only a first movement which does not really merit the word sorrow. Mm-hmm. I don't know to what extent I find it plausible to apply that distinction to emotional states, either in Stoicism or from Maimonides. Maimonides doesn't really deal with it directly. But it's a fascinating question. And if it could, perhaps some kind of a distinction can be drawn, between sadness and sorrow, or I don't know how exactly conceptually to what kind of a terminology to use to do it. Fascinating.
Yes, please.
Thanks. I did have a question for Drew, but just to pick up on the question that you asked, it's a very practical one, very doctor-based question, one in which I understand where that comes from. And I'd say that back in 1993, David Morris published a book called The Culture of Pain. It's fairly well-known study, and David Morris is a literary studies scholar, not a physician, but he did base a lot of his research on experience in the tertiary pain clinics, which were at that time just really getting going in the United States. And he developed what he called the myth of two pains. What is the difference, actually, he asked. And I think that has a lot of basis today. To be able to distinguish, functional MRI studies are done looking at the brain, the modern Rorschach test, you know, colors change, and look what we found. But what is the difference? Well, unfortunately, we have a definitional problem with the IASP, which was instituted to standardize research, in which states right in the definition that experience is pain. So it's not just physical sensation, it's also experience. So how do you distinguish when you have a patient in front of you, what pain? Your question is, what is pain? And pain, according to our discipline, according to the IASP definition, is experience, also expression of pain in terms of metaphors of damage and weaponry. So definitionally, we haven't made a distinction. And I think that your question kind of roots down into, are we still able to separate? Are we able to alchemize out? Are we able to filter out physical pain versus a subjective sensation, which may not be based on a physical sensation of pain? And I don't know if it's possible. That is the quandary that we're talking about, this embodied experience. I also share your reticence with the prescription of opiates for primarily psychological problems. There's a public health disaster with opiates. Also in Canada, where I'm from. In fact, Canada just overtook the Americans in terms of opiate consumption last year.
Congratulations.
Yeah. It's something not to be proud of, for sure. But again, it's that physician's perspective of, I have this problem called pain, and I'm going to prescribe a drug for it. And I think that's the wrong footing that medicine makes. But it's not medicine's fault, because largely society wants that panacea, that cure, and it names medicine as the arbiter or carrier for that particular magic, which we don't have. So in essence, I think that it's a social public policy problem that you are being forced to solve without an adequate or even reasonable solution that ultimately ends up as a pharmacology that causes more problems, I think, than it was intended really to alleviate.
Thank you. Last question.
You asked, Drew, if we have comments, and I just want to state briefly that we should talk first, because my next research would be on cannabis in Israel specifically, but also the U.S. And my current research is on sleep and sleep problems. So I relate to much of what you both of you just said, but I would like to think that this discussion could be helpful to you. What's your name again?
Simon.
Because now perhaps you see the point of view, you know, you see it when you in your clinical practice, but perhaps hear more about the experience of the patient, the point of view of the patient, and you see why it's confusing not only to you, but also to the patient. So in that way, maybe you can understand how difficult it would be to account for his or her pain, because they don't really know. As Drew said, there is a lot of uncertainty involved. And what you're expecting is, because you have to rely on the patient's narrative, is more certainty, but he or she cannot provide it. So in that sense, it shows that, your comment shows that it's not just experiential paradoxes, but it's also diagnostic ones. It's also, it affects the clinical practice as well. So in that sense, maybe it could be helpful to you. I would also want to highlight what you mentioned. You actually took my question, because I wanted to mention that in my work on fatigue, I could just replace much of what you said about pain and just write fatigue, and it's exactly the same thing. So in that sense, your response about, you know, the uniqueness of pain, still I would love to hear more about it, but we can do that during the break.
Well, just quickly in relation to the last comment, I do think there probably are some commonalities when you examine aversive states such as fatigue or pain, which once again set us up in a kind of potentially dissonant relationship with our own body. And then there probably are also particular differences and distinctions. A phenomenology of fatigue would not end up looking identical to a phenomenology of chronic pain. And one might say that as well with forms of psychological distress, like depression, or even modes of schizophrenia, derealization, where once again, you might see some interesting kind of overlapping phenomena in how somebody feels about their body, or the way in which the external world is straight of meaning, or overlap with fatigue. But then also there would be this kind of phenomenological specificity that would set each state off from one another, just as clinically you would set each state off from one another in a medical textbook. I think we need kind of phenomenological textbooks that really examine what's common and what's different about each of these, quote, disorders.
I want to say that we take it for granted that that pain is of negative significance. It's self-evident for us. And what I take from Maimonides and Kierkegaard, each in his own particular way, is that there's actually nothing self-evident about it. That other people, at other times, in other cultures, belonging to different religious traditions or to the same as ours, think completely differently about pain. And for some, it has no significance. It's of neutral value. And for others, it can assume positive significance. So I think actually it's worth taking it into account in any discussion.
All right. Wonderful. So with this note, we should move on to the next. Our speaker is Dr. Chagai Boaz. Dr. Boaz holds a PhD in sociology from this university. His field of expertise is the sociology of health and bioethics, and he has written mainly on the political economy of organ transplantations. Specifically, he is interested in the embeddedness of medical technologies in social settings and the interplay between morals, politics, and technology. Dr. Boaz is also the program director of the Edmond J. Safra Center for Ethics, and he has done a lot to organize this conference. The commentator, Professor Galili Shaha, to my left, he's a professor of comparative literature of German studies, and he's here at Tel Aviv University, and he serves as the director of the Minerva Institute for German History at the university.
Thank you. This is actually a work in progress, and many ideas that somehow turn to be glued together, and I hope it will make some sense. So, in his most celebrated fable, The Happy Prince, Oscar Wilde introduced a particular version of sacrifice. The act of sacrifice is taking place outside the human world, in a universe composed of birds and statues. Compassion, self-sacrifice, and altruism do exist. The happy prince, which is, and I quote, is gilded all over with thin leaves of fine gold, two bright sapphires for eyes, and a large red ruby glowed on his sword hilt, but with a heart made of lead, end of quote, sends the swallow to dismantle his body, piece by piece, both his eyes, his skin of gilded leaves, and to deliver his precious body parts to the poor and the miserable. after sacrificing his valuable body parts, realizing that he is also sacrificing the future life of the swallow in the warm climate of Egypt, the leaden heart of the prince snaps into two, resembling the ultimate sacrifice. As he is no longer beautiful, he is no longer useful, says the art professor at the university. In The Happy Prince, as well as in his other fables such as The Selfish Giant, Wilde criticizes the utilitarian atomistic society in which the concern for the other is expunged by self-interest and egocentrism. In such a world, where social relations are totally secularized, stripped out to their naked self-interest exchange, it seems as there is no room for heroism, irrational altruism, and emotion. What then are the signs of self-sacrifice in our modern individualistic society? Does self-sacrifice still bear the forms of the sacred? Etymologically, sacrifice means a sacred deed. Does any aspect of the sacred still remain in the practice of modern self-sacrifice? Can we identify the Via Dolorosa, the passion, the passion, the visual pain of the martyr, of the tortured body in our modern time? In this talk, I wish to discuss a specific form of self-sacrifice, which is present in our technological world of modern medicine, a donation of a kidney from a living person to a stranger. This form of donation varies from other versions of organ transfers. In contrast to the common direct living organ donation, this donation is not about saving one's own relative. It is not offering your kidney to a needed friend or even to an acquaintance. It is a donation of a kidney to a complete stranger. In living donations, the sacrifice, obviously, is not total as in deceased donations. The donor will bear the signs of the sacrifice throughout his or her life. The donor's body, the now one kidney body, a deficient body, becomes then a testimony of the sacrifice, of the voluntarily sacrifice. In order to deeply understand the meaning of this form of self-sacrifice, the third one, which is different from the family and the state, and I'll return to that later, in order to deeply understand this meaning, I wish to delve into the anthropology of the sacrificed body. Galili Shachar, to my left, and my commentator, argues that the sacred body is the body which transcends corporeality. The sacred body is the body which transforms into sacredness out of pain, misery, and suffering. The sacrificed body presents us with the internal contradiction. It is both a public manifestation of unbearable pain at the same time as the defeat of the aching flesh by transcending into holiness. Sacredness, thus, emerges from the soaring flesh, from the wounded body. This is the dialectic of sacrifice. The injured body, the deficient body, finds its completion in the blessing. The completion of the injured body as a sign of the blessing could be seen as the theological framing of the sacrificed body in Western culture. This is the story of the crucified, as well as the story of Prometheus, which liver is eaten again and again by vulture. This wound becomes the symbol for the blessed. Therefore, pain, in its pre-medicalized period, was conceived, perhaps, as a gateway to sacredness, as the mark of the holy. The resemblance between organ donation and Judeo-Christian roots of self-sacrifice supposed to, presumably, mitigate the acceptance of transplant medicine in Western society. Indeed, in Catholic societies such as Spain and Ireland, the rates of deceased organ donations are among the highest in the world. The papal approval of the practice already in its inceptive years has certainly eased Christians to hold organ donor cards. Don't take your organs to heaven, heaven knows we need them here, is a slogan emphasizing the religion appeal of organ donation and underscores the importance of religion as a mediating agency between transplant medicine and society. Israel, in this respect, makes an interesting case. although it has high-level transplant medicine, full insurance covering for post-operative organ recipients and advanced transplant centers, it lags far behind developed society in its organ donation rates. The reasons are often ascribed to the opposition of ultra-Orthodox circles to the definition of brain death, a precondition for deceased organ donations. Religion, therefore, has been understood as an inhibitor rather than a facilitator of organ donations in Israel. And here you see the focus of a state agency and others on religion. These are both signing for organ donor cards, which has a religious emphasis on it. The poor rates of deceased organ donations in Israel led to alternative channels of organ supply for kidney patients. Living donations are possible way out of the lengthening waiting list. Anonymous living donors compose such an alternative channel of organ supply. In Israel, this version of organ transfer is orchestrated by Gift of Life, Matnat Chaim organization that has dramatically turned the tide here in the supply of organ donation. My talk is about this organization. Matnat Chaim was founded in 2009 as a charity fund by Rabbi Ishayahu Heber, a kidney recipient himself, who is both the organization's chairperson and administrator. On its website, the fund takes pride of its hundreds of successful matches between donors and recipients. Indeed, the life project of Heber is remarkable in its actual achievements. It has already matched more than 300 pairs of unrelated donors and recipients as of May 2016. The Jewish religious character of the fund is eye-catching. It is often referred to as the Haredi, the ultra-Orthodox fund of kidney donations. The reaching out operations of the organizations are often conducted in synagogues, through local papers read by Orthodox population, and in rather closed religious communities. A quick skimming over the fund's publication reveals a prominent use of religious discourse, and its website is replete with events from Jewish day-to-day religious life. Here are some sociological figures. This is the number of donations that the organization has procured during the recent years. This is up to April 2016. And here we see the gender distribution, which is interesting because in living donation, we are often meet with an opposite gender gap in which women donate more to than men. And in this organization, we see that there is a reverse. We can refer to that later in the discussion. But what interests me mostly is the religious aspect of this organization. And the centrality of religion in this context is striking. Whereas high levels of religiosity among Israeli Jews were considered as a barrier to organ donations due to the debate over the definition of brain death, Matnat Chaim presents us with a reverse correlation. High level of religiosity become, apparently, facilitator rather than inhibitor to organ donations. So far, there was not one non-Jew among the donor procured by the organization, and only one non-Jew recipient. It should be noted that Matnat Chaim has no stated clear discriminatory policy, and at the formal level, it is open to all sectors of Israeli society. Yet, its salient religious feature implies the homogeneity of its inscribed population of both donors and recipients. The distinct character of closed and consolidated community is perhaps the organization's key of turning religious identity to a driving force of organ donation. I wish to dedicate the last minutes of my talk to understanding this. In February 2016, the organization has gathered 120 donors to spend a weekend together. Reviewing this event, journalist Stern reports, and I quote, the participants are all alike, and this homogeneity immediately catches the eye. black and knitted kippahs, scarves, toupee, and head covering for women, and only a handful of secular. Ruti, a donor, tells the reporter how proud she is in saving the life of a Jewish boy. I quote, "The emphasis on the recipient's religion is not accidental," writes the reporter. "Time and again, donors repeat how they insisted on donating only to Jews." And here is the quotation. "It is about people with values," says Ashira Ben Shachar, a 39 years old nurse whose husband donated a kidney a year ago. The couple lives in Pnei Kedem settlement. "It is at the end of the world," she laughs. "Compared to us, you are living in a busy city," comments her table partner Moshe Tzuriel from Peduel settlement, who donated his kidney a few months ago to a woman with a mental disability. "I, as all the donors from Peduel, have reached Matnat Chaim through Gabi Revivo that has spread the word, and 6 persons from our settlement become donors." Gabi joins the table, hugs Moshe, and laughs. "We are in competition with Hitzar, another settlement. We lead for now 6-5. "And was it important to you donating to a specific sector?" Moshe, "I did not limit the donation, but it was important to me that the recipient will be Jewish." Ruti, "The issue of donating to Jews is pretty common. It is a request which I know is acceptable among donors. Some wish to donate to a child, some to a woman, some to young, and some wish benefiting the old." "If saving life, why this condition? Isn't that a bit racist?" Menachem, "I am first of all concerned with the troubles of my own people. Charity begins at home. If I am making this big step and giving something out of me, I wish to give it to someone for my own people. This is natural, and this is also my right." The donor's religiosity serves as their common habitus. They act, behave, and speak the social language of contemporary Orthodox Israeli Judaism. This is the framing of their social life. Nonetheless, I suggest reading the Matnat Chaim phenomenon as reflecting a constellation of religious framing and individualistic agency. Community and agency in living unrelated organ donation in Israel, and here I wish to offer a sociological account of how religion plays a role in the procurement of organ donors. Sociologist Peterim Sorokin has coined the term creative altruism, arguing that altruistic behavior generates more circle of altruistic behavior, and this enhances social solidarity. The competition between the two small settlements, two small communities, exemplifies how altruism begets wider circle of altruistic behavior and an in-group sense of social solidarity. Many donors admit to learn on the possibility to donate a kidney to a stranger from a first-hand experience, a relative, a friend, or even a moving story in the newspaper. Once entered the donors club, they are becoming enthusiastic of telling publicly their own story, expanding even further the impact of creative altruism. So far, the impact of creative altruism has not breached through the sociological segregation walls of Israeli society. Not only that all donors come from the majority Jewish population, but also within this population they seem as a very sectorial group. But it is specifically in the context of small group networking that I suggest understanding the impact of creative altruism. It seems as if the donation creates an ideal conduct, a challenge to be followed by others who conceive themselves as idealistic persons, as committed to what they see as a high level of behavior and conduct. I quote, "We are all people with values." In small homogenic societies, Gemeinschaft, as sociologist Tunis termed it, the effect of challenging the community's member with a higher ideal of conduct is bigger than in more heterogenic social context. Against this background, it is no wonder that the ideal of donating a kidney to a stranger is spread by social media which are communal and sectorial. This ideal conduct is then embedded into the communal order of deeds and charities as an example of elite morality. It is no less than the ultimate charity, a challenge for the faith holder. Limiting the donation to Jewish patients alone is perhaps another indicator of the in-group sense of closed homogenic community. The charity begins at home, home being a Jewish home, can only be exercised from the institutional standing status of Matnat Chaim as a third sector fund from the donor stand and from the donor standing as private initiators of organ donations. Combined with the political reality of social life in Israel, charity begins at home is another screen of excluding practices. As a private initiative, the fund and the donor are not obliged to the norms of and the values of democratic society. They have the privilege not to follow equity in the selection of potential donors. If we understand the political economy of organ supply as the interplay between state, the family, and the market, then Matnat Chaim stands in between these social institutions. In matching strangers as donor and recipient, it exhibits traits that pertain to the state that orchestrates such altruistic transfers in deceased organ donations. In its status as private organization, which is not as obliged to the Universal Code of Citizenship and acts according to a different register of preferences, the organization resembles a market agent, or at least a non-profit organization. But above all, Matnat Chaim is closer to the family in its donation practices. It is not only that the family becomes a prominent discursive idiom for the community of donors and recipients, but also in its in-group conception as a unit with clear boundaries. In this sense, charity begins at home can be read as the particular giving that characterizes intrafamilial donation. As the parent donates to her own specific child and not to another child, and places the health of her own child at the top of her interest, so thus the Jewish donor conditions his donation within what he understands as his extended family of the Jewish people. The normative expectation of commitment and sacrifice within the family unit is translated to the extended family. The family, the pre-modern institution of the household, precedes the state. In-group belonging overpowers notions of citizenship. Oops. I wish to suggest another layer of explanation to the insistence of donors to limit themselves to only to Jewish population. In addition to the in-group belonging, the community as extended family, I see their request as resulting from what could be termed as excessive agency. In deceased donations, agency is limited to expressing your consent to become an organ donor. It is impossible to set conditions or to direct your donation to a specific group of people or to a particular individual. In living donations, however, donors enjoy a larger set of possibilities to exercise their agency. Reading stories of living donors display self-account of doing, of active roles, of initiatives, of making choices, of taking decisions. Altruism indeed obliges an active role. Nonetheless, the active role of the living anonymous donor has no limits. It is not restricted by formal ethics. It is not restricted by formal ethical regulations other than communal norms. As the act of cutting one of your kidneys and giving it to a stranger is indeed an extreme act, the transgression is translated into the ethical field. The saving of life empowers self-esteem of the donor, emphasizes even further his potent agency. As cited above, the donor chooses whether they prefer a young or an old recipient, man or woman, and above all, they prefer to donate to Jews. As free agents experimenting with the challenge of donating a kidney, these donors are often project their world of values into their act of donation. This is where I see their agency as excessive. It has no ethics rather than the ethics of self-doing. It seems as if being qualified as altruistic, that is, not driven to donation by materialistic considerations, grants a license to act as an elite which is obliged to know ethics rather than one's self-code of moral preferences. Ironically, this excessive agency of self-doing, which can be read as egocentric maybe, becomes other-oriented and altruistic towards stranger and is saving life. Conclusion. Where the story of Matnat Chaim fits in this chain of bodily sacrifices? Does it display a revival of the sacred, now an altruistic donor? The sacrifice in body, as argued in the beginning of this talk, indicates the transcending into holiness. Kidney donation imitates such bodily sacrifices and thus serves as a direct continuation of the theological roots of bodily sacrifices. Nonetheless, living organ donation is ingrained in the contemporary reality of modern society. It is not only about the modern uses of advanced medical technologies, but also the framing of the anonymous living donations in a modern sociological setting of individual agency and community. Limiting the donation to Jews does dissonance with universal understanding of altruism, but it is this limitation that provides another evidence of the more secularized perception of the act, not as directed above as a token of faith, but rather as rooted in the messy reality of here and now social relations. In this sense, it is about value choices. That is, it is about generating new bioethics of organ donations. It provides an alternative to the liberal bioethics that does not necessarily go back to theology.
Thank you. Professor Shahab.
Thank you, Yaacov. Right. It is with much interest that I read and now hear the rich paper submitted by Dr. Haggai Boaz dealing with the modern theology of sacrificing and the case of organ donations. Now, I'm not to offer a review of his rich essay, but rather a few remarks on the theoretical frameworks of his talk and its methodological implications, or a few of them. The major argument made in the first part of his paper is that living organ donations can be understood as a new mode of self-sacrificing, which we normally associated with the sacred order and with theological conceptions of being, such as the martyr, the holy wound, the redeemer. In modern Western culture and society, this mode of self-sacrificing is being transformed, adapted, internalized, rationalized, materialized into the secular order. This all depends if one accepts the existence of secular order as such, and if yes, what kind of secular order is being accepted. But we are not to discuss this question now. But rather, we should agree that sacrificing, which once and still is identified with the sacred order, the order of the divine, is being aufgehoben, right, and transformed into higher modern organizations and agencies of life and death, so of decision on life and death, in which sacrificing is being replaced with different sets of concepts or of values which are not necessarily occupied or recalled by God's name. This is, in my view, a good reason to deal with the theological remnants and the leftovers of martyrs and sacred bodies in the modern era, in our own time, for what we often understand as secular or liberal being identified with effective functioning social order based on scientific hermeneutics of the body and with rational individual thinking and acting, still bears, as we know, its own mythical power, its own destructive means of violence, its own wound. And what we would wish to think as secular or even as liberal is often another form of a miserable religion. However, the argument made here by Haggai is more concrete.
He asks about the possibilities of thinking the case of organ donations as sacrificing, which is not only based on the Judaic Christian traditions of martyrs, but rather on its transformation into a modern progressive social order that is rather based on ethical decisions of individuals. And again, we have suspended the critical discussion regarding the possibilities of the modern social as such, namely the secular to be, without assuming the existence of certain theological preconditions, partially being distorted, however, still ones that secular itself depends on. So it's like an interruption, ongoing, right? It's very difficult to speak of the secular without those collapses into the theological precondition, even it is, right, distorted or unseen or forgotten. Yet, this is the argument Haggai is making. We can and should imagine the possibilities of justifying organ donation as an ethical act, a performance of altruism, which not only seems to contradict the assumptions regarding the ideals and values of modern being, this is more into your first part, it seems impossible now in that age, right, to donate, right, to the stranger, so-called. However, so an age in which we are turning more and more selfish, right, for this is the era of the ego in which we live, governed by the self-images and the neglect or the forgetfulness of the other as such, which is not identified with the self, right? The other as such, which is the unfamiliar and not another self. There are alternatives for the social and political government of the self, alternatives which partially are associated with the religious. This is perhaps the tone I heard in Haggai's paper. For theological institutions or religious traditions, Haggai shows, can actually play a progressive role in justifying organ donation using some kind of utilitarian argument suggesting an ethical dimension to the medical discourse and the social conception of donation as the gift of life. It seems thus that in the case of organ donation, the relics of Christian and Jewish traditions, not to speak of the Muslim, right, there's another complications there, the leftovers of the sacred order are in play and are partially transformed to contemporary progressive discourse on altruism, and even become an avant-garde of certain medical ethics and social practices regarding living donations. This is the case of Spain, Italy, and
Ireland.
Right, and certain areas in Israel. Donations, however, and this should be an argument, are not merely acts of martyrs. The giving up of a body organ for the life of the other and even risking your own life for a stranger is not an ideal, pure act of self-sacrificing as long as this is not performed by the name of God. This is an argument to make. Namely, associated with the sacred order. What is left is the mythical remnant of the theological order which offers itself anew. And this is different. This is different. We are dealing with mythical remnants of the theological order. That is to say, with the political power which is left. However, this could be a lesson, and I think a good lesson, on the dialectic of the secular and the vicinity of the liberal social order, which everywhere today is in a great need for foundational legitimization and therefore base itself today on reinterpretations or reperformances of theological traditions. So we need the religious in order, right, to justify what the secular cannot make because it collapses in the self, right? This is the argument, again, the tone I heard. This is also the case in the state of Israel. So now the remarks on, this, on the last part of your article, as we are familiar with. As the discourses of civil society, law institutions, and the public sphere collapse, those empty spaces, no man's land of the state, are being filled with agencies of all kinds. Right, it's Afrata Gdola, right, of the public sphere. Those inabilities of the state and of the civil spheres, which is even worse, lead often to alternatives such as Matnat Chaim, the gift of life, an ultra-Orthodox organization, Haggai shows, that plays a crucial leading role in turning the organ donation Israel from almost being a taboo into what he called an excessive agency, so too much of a discourse and of justification, which redefines the terms of donation in voluntary terms, preferring, however, a donation traffic that is from Jews to Jews, creating a kind of frame of community, a kind of extended family that is a small nation, eine Gemeinschaft, I would prefer eine kleine Nation, right? Ein Städtel, which is a settlement, right? Which, however, is not based on civil agreements and solidarities, but rather on kinships which are mimetic to the relations of blood. So we are already and always on the mimetic stages, right? Faith or race. This is what we call, what I call the beginning, a miserable religion. For it's based on a false interpretations of tradition and the turning of the real subject, the other, the stranger, the unfamiliar, into a collective selfness. So there's a wrong way of stabilizing tradition as such. And again, it is because of the vicinity of the secular order itself that we recreate what tradition is. It might be, as Haggai argues very well, that agencies as such, religious of their kind, what I argue to be false in terms of not offering a radical interpretation to the open dimension of Jewish tradition, but rather in stressing its exclusive layer. So we are like in a debate on what is tradition, where I suggest to offer a more nihilistic view on the open dimension of it, and to argue more against, right, the idea of its stable or valuable dimensions. However, we are in agreement that it contributes to the public policies and practices of organ donations, a policy, a practice that might end with saving life. It's a strong argument in your paper. Now, this, however, should call us into a different path of thinking, recalling the question, the forgotten one, namely, what is life that merits? So life that is free from those false abstractions and interpretations. So the argument, it saves life, it's not the end of the game, but rather its beginning. It recalls, right, a discussion on the loss of being. It calls us indeed, and here I'm in agreement with Haggai, to return to the realm of tradition, free, however, from false values and determinations regarding the human conditions or the exclusive kinship, but rather as a playful bodies, dialectic enough, so secular and sacred at the same time, right, for engaging the concreteness of the unfamiliar, that is a neighbor, a god or a man living among us. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Shaha. Comments.
Points, questions.
Yes.
One, which is up in a campaign. It's central to the construction of organ donation from the live that it's innocuous, painless, it's a mere discomfort. So part of the rhetoric justifying or behind it, it's not a big issue. So it's the sacrifice, non-sacrifice, and it's not something everybody is running to do, but it's not clear at all what the sacrifice is in it. If you think of archetypal sacrifice as the sacrifice of Isaac or other sufferings, this is there's a vacuum here that we need to fill in conceptually, psychologically. Second, more specifically about the sociology of this event, maybe you refer to, there's a particular context. There's not a group of people mobilizing religious values in a new enterprise of donation from the living. It seems that for many ultra-Orthodox people, there is a religious problem with donation from the dead. This is, for good or for bad, the default practice in the West. It creates a sense of discord. They have been pressed under much public pressure, even laws suggesting in a way or proposals to exclude non-donors from reception. So this donation, this sacrifice is not so much voluntary. It's excessive agency on the individual. but it's a product of a very particular social pressure and construction of duty to each other.
Just quick for for Galili, then to Yechiel. First of all, thank you for this very rich comment, and I have to pick some of the points that you made in order to say something about this miserable religion of secular. And I think that when I started with The Happy Prince of Oscar Wilde, I thought maybe I will leave it out, but for me it stands as a paradigm, the way in which in modern society altruism becomes the conduct of the non-humans. And indeed, the study of altruism is mostly manifested in sociobiology. I think I'm writing this somewhere in the paper, that it is no coincidence that sociobiology picks on altruism, because the way you described the very tense dialectics between the theological roots of sacrificing to the sacred order, and now that God is dead, so to speak, and now we have to exercise our social relations on a different register, it creates a social desire for reconceptualizing again and again the way that society ought to be conducted. And it is no wonder that, or when Auguste Comte frames the term altruism, he refers to the ideal, to not yet actualized, to the future stage of society, which is not present. This is just a quick comment to one of your points. And Yechiel, I agree with both points. The sacrifice of living donation is more complex than it seems on its even medical record, because on the one side it says it has no risk. It's 0.0 something like of risk of death. There was one incident in Israel of a living donor who died on the operation bed. Furthermore, there is some studies proving that living organ donors conduct a much healthier life than average. So what's the sacrifice here, you ask? And you're making another layer of complexity to the discourse and to the rhetoric, and I agree with that. And I also agree with the second point, that religion has to be understood more as a sociological factor that has to take into account the political context, the cultural context of the brain death controversy, of what is meant to be and the pressure to become an organ donor, at least a donor card holder. And I think that you are right that the phenomenon and the organization, the Matnat Chaim, needs to understood also against this background.
Yes, please. Can you pass the mic?
Okay.
Is it? And who?
You.
Okay. So, thank you. Very interesting, both in presentation and the comments on it. The part that I want to address is tied to, it seems you had one side of a contrast class associated with Gemeinschaft, but without the work that would do vis-a-vis Gesellschaft when speaking about the social order. So with respect to the secular, sort of these broader projects of the social where sort of what was required was what was available, you know, the view from nowhere, from everywhere at the same time, sort of absent of robust content. And it seems in those contexts, sacrifice for the social is disaster, right? It's means to the larger machine. So you get this sparse content there, which means where are you going to find that robust content? It's going to be in terms of much thicker narratives. And it's at those places where you get sort of a richer frame for sacrifice. And then, you know, sort of how you unpack it, that's going to be narrative specific. It's going to be tied to, you know, which narrative. And so the question then is, to what degree is it possible to generalize from, say, the account you've given, say, in Israel, the context of Israel, and the kinds of narratives involved, justification for sacrifice, vis-a-vis other contexts where it seems when you move to Gemeinschaft and you have that more robust narrative, kind of the nature, the justification, and what will motivate it, it's going to then shift in appropriate ways. So is this, to what degree, generalizable? And do you need to make this narrative specific? And then you're going to have sort of different interesting variants of this intersection of the secular and, you know, religious or some robust tradition.
If I understand you right, I think that I have an answer in the sense that organ donations or organ transfers, let's say, universally, follow kind of the same political economy dynamics, that is the interplay between the state, the market, the family, against the background of shortage and with the flourishing of agencies such as Matnat Chaim, which can be found as parallels in other places, not specifically religious, but private initiatives, NGOs, and other agencies of matching living donors with patients outside the premises of the state. So I guess that in the world of organ transplant, this could be a very interesting case of the Israeli case, or in general of a country, of a society which has any means, any technological, any medical means of promoting organ donations, yet its organ donor rates are very poor, and this is one layer. And the second layer is the sociological organization of how this can be explained in sociological factors. So I guess this could be different in and varies according to societies and according to political and cultural setting, but I think that there are some universals in the sense of in the resemblance between organ donation and religion, and in the theological roots of the sacrificed body and so on and so forth. So,
very short remark, because the question was very interesting, and you know it's Sagat's paper is not mine, right? But I find it very interesting the way you elaborate what we call the social, or even the political project of modernity. You know, and then perhaps, you know, the context that perhaps is missing here is the association between the organ donation and the war machines of modernity, right? Since the French Revolution, the Napoleon era, First and Second World War, to contemporary Israel. And where the discourse, false or right, on sacrificing is being time and again use and misuse. And during this time, if you look on certain halachic discourses in Jewish tradition, in different frames, you will see a resistance to sacrifice in terms it is a false sacrifice for the state, for Israel as such. And therefore, the so-called the sacred discourse withdraw from that, right? And create actually a moment of resistance. And even, you know, if you continue that, going back to Yechiel's remark on Isaac, or even on Jesus, and act of, there are more, I will argue, secular commentaries on sacrifice. Because if you look at a Talmud or Tafsir or different, you know, church interpretations, there will you find, you know, degree of freedom, including critique and different way of transforming, right, the act of sacrificing into mimetic degrees, right, of telling about that, mm-hmm. and so on. So I like in that matter to add, right, this moment of resistance, and this is why I would try, you know, to argue to be dialectic enough in order, you know, to be in play with paradoxical one, with both traditions. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah. And
thank you. Thanks, Agai. I really enjoyed reading the paper. The first presentation today problematized the distinction between body and mind, and in many ways the institutionalization of organ donation problematizes the boundary between the individual and the collective in a kind of obvious way. But I'm trying to think about the psychosocial dynamics of pain and how it's transformed when it's mediated through the institution. So in thinking about classical kinship and anthropology, Marshall Salins last year basically reviewed it all and said, if we think about it, kinship is essentially living each other's lives at the bottom line when we look at it cross-culturally. And so giving an organ should ultimately create a very strong kind of kinship tie, but when it's mediated through this donation institution, that network or that connection is precluded. So my question is, in what sense does your work speak to kinship theory and challenge it or forward it, and how biological technologies relate to kinship? And also, where is the potential collective pain? Like, if somebody gives an organ, it's not just individual pain. The psychosocial dynamics of pain would obviously presumably be shared with close kin and family and acquaintances. So in what sense, then, does this donation institution mediate this collective pain? And what kind of metaphysical communities does it generate? I think I'm hearing we're talking about national community, ethno-religious community. So it might be interesting to think about the way in which the institution becomes a reservoir for some kind of collective suffering, and what kind of constitutive social work that does.
I suggest maybe that we collect, because yes. The microphone here is ahead, and I will answer all of
them. Hagai, thank you very much for the paper. I'm wondering why you seem to sort of conflate the sacrifice and the gift. It seems like you could have gone in a different direction and said there's two very different discourses here. There's the discourse of the sacrifice and the discourse of the gift. The discourse of the sacrifice, it might be seen as this in the, you know, Niebuhrian sense of the ultimate basis of ethics is the sacrifice, the complete giving of the self till death. In Christian ethics, and that, even though in America and many other places it's called the gift of life, really the underlying discourse is one of sacrifice. The living donation discourse in Israel consciously also takes this name, the gift of life, but it seems almost to be rejecting the idea of sacrifice. And in doing so, maybe it's embracing the idea of the gift, whereas the sacrifice in Christian ethics is universal. In order to save the entire world, the gift ethic is communal. It is always focused on a continual sustenance of community. And so maybe there's just two different kinds of ethics going on here.
Yes, please.
Thank you, Hagai. I have a question, which is a practical one. How is the living, the altruistic living donation in the States? Is it also related to this community-oriented ethos? This is my first question. The second question is, how would such a Jewish religious perspective as the one that you highlighted react to, for example, something like selling your organs to give the money to the community? Would that, how does that differ? Does that differ? Is, because I'm interested, because of course on the Christian perspective, selling would always be just because it's an act of a money transaction. Would so does the community justify that act? Would the community justify that act?
It's a point that Moshe Halbertal makes in his book on sacrifice, which I think is a good point. And what he says is basically that the transition from giving to giving up has to do with the fear that the giving, the gift that is given, is ultimately a self-serving gift, because it's part of it can become a transaction. Accompanied by an expectation to receive something from God in return. And in order to avoid that fear of the gift becoming part of a transaction, there is a shift into giving up. And the more, presumably, the more you give up, the more you love the one that you give up, what it is that you give up for. And it's tempting to see the transition as a mistake, some kind of mistake that brings in a conceptual mistake in the concept of sacrifice, and that ultimately shows itself in the logic that says that if you don't give up everything, then your love is meaningless, it's worthless.
Okay, so if it's here, I'll answer. Okay. So, Ian, about kinship. First of all, the idea of living donations stemmed out from the fact that genetic proximity promised a good chance of a successful transplant. But nowadays, today with advances in medical technologies, it is possible to even enlarge the pool of organ donors beyond the genetic pools of proximity, and to receive organs from people who only share your blood type, and now even that can be extended even further. And that bears a significant anthropological meaning, in terms that relatedness is now more an anthropological understanding of kinship rather than biological or medical. And sure, this has many methodological and theoretical implications in the social study of organ donations and the social reality. Sure, that's a way that need to be followed in this research. Ari, about your comment, thank you. I need to think it over and to and maybe we'll talk later to see how specifically how to embed it into this analysis. Marta, living donation in Israel, in the state level, are different in both the ethical level and in the procedural level. First of all, you need to undergo a committee that approves and qualify the donor. Actually, also this, all organ donations in Israel have to be authorized by the state agency in order that the transplant will be taking place in Israel. If you are coming with a donor you need, with a living donor, you need to prove that there is no materialistic considerations are involved in any way, and that the donor is eligibly, is medically eligible for donation. And there is a tension that I'd rather not go into it right now between the transplant center operated by the Ministry of Health and this private organization, on the basis that, actually I mentioned in my talk, they have a different standing, and they are not obliged to the ethical code that the Ministry of Health is obliged to, needs to comply with. The second question about religious standing for people who donate their or sell their kidney in order to provide money for the community. Actually, this is not usual. There is a ban, and the prohibition is very clear against any form of organ trafficking and organ selling. And I don't know any particular case of someone who wishes to sell his organs and take them and give the money to a community.
Is it prohibited halakhically or legally?
Legally, and I know that there are declarations of rabbis saying that this is immoral. Yeah. Hami, this is the gift relations and the sacrifices, the tension between these two, let's say, moral economies of the self versus God or versus the other is very interesting, and there is rich anthropological literature which I'm familiar about the economy of the gift and the self rewarding gift and the expectation of reward. And of course this is also embedded in the sense of the gift of life. What could be rewarded when once giving you your own life? But yes, I will take a look into Moshe Halbertal's book and see how it helps me.
All right, so let's collect a few more questions. We have 5 minutes till we end, so you'll have the prerogative of not answering the question. Yes, please, in the back.
On Ali's comment, I think it's commendable that you were brave enough to make that paradigmatic leap from the discourse of altruism with its universalistic preconceptions to the communal one with its exceptional preconceptions. And I always go for intellectual comfort to the forefathers' teachings, so I take Durkheim this time, and I think Durkheim supports you in that, because he equates what Galili called the order of the divine with the order of the social. And if this is the case, here you have the link between the religious practice and ethos and the social in its communal sense. And this is quite, you know, it's not politically correct. This is why it's so commendable.
It's okay. He addressed
the
end.
Can you pass down the mic?
Thank you.
So, Chagai, you've been offered a few models to think about this donation. So you started with the sacrifice and the martyr. Michael offered that this is in fact in some ways a debt, or conceived to be a debt, or Ali said a gift rather than a sacrifice. I want to offer another model. In a way, this is a case in which these people in their own conception, especially those coming from the settlements, are people who already made the sacrifice before the donation. They are already martyrs. They're living out there in what they seem to be think as a great sacrifice to the nation. But this is a sacrifice that is not recognized by great parts of the nation. So these are, in some ways, unfortunate martyrs. It reminds me of Kierkegaard's discussion of Abraham that the real challenge is after. You know, after he walks down from the mountain, not the sacrifice of Isaac, but how do you continue to live when you're not recognized as a martyr? And I think that this is the it's not a miserable religion, it's a miserable martyr who wants to be recognized as a martyr. And the excessiveness of the acts are actually an attempt to gain recognition for the sacrifice that has already been made, but was not recognized. Now, I know that this is not the most generous reading of what otherwise would seem as a noble deed, and so I qualify, but I do think that it's important that it's coming from these specific people who do see themselves as big, you know, also the ultra-Orthodox in some ways. You know, they're killing themselves in studying Torah, and they're not getting the nation's recognition for that sacrifice.
So when you answer, you just give us the details, the data. Are religious analysts contributing more, donating more than the old?
Okay, so
may I say something short?
Oh, there was Shane also can before we yeah. we.
If it follows, go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah. No, if it follows. I just speaking from Canada, your questions about, you know, is this racist or not? In Canada, with the universal healthcare system, I think many Canadians would think indeed that such a practice would be racist, but it would be moot because the Canada Health Act just makes such private healthcare illegal based on the socialized system that's in Canada. So it's kind of besides the point. It just would not be allowed to occur. You get prosecuted. But I was, based on your talk, I was, because I'm a doctor, efficacy really kind of appeals to me. And the most eye-popping part of your paper was numbers. You know, so it's working. Like, that's the thing that I see. I see something really popping out at me saying, this is effective. And I'm wondering, so my question is based on quantification. And in Canada, there is, and I'm sure in Israel as well, there's no serial donation, right? It's a one-time instance for the living. But the practice of blood donation actually does have numbers attached to it based on how many times one donates, which is a maximum, I think, of once a month or something. You can eventually get the equivalent of a platinum card based on a series of donations over the course of 20, 30 years. You increasingly get recognition for your altruistic acts, which becomes kind of competitive. And based on the numbers that I see and the kind of almost exponential, not quite, but the rapid rise in number of donations which is occurring in this private institution, I'm wondering if there's a implication for that rise that could be explained more than simply just success begets success. Is there a sinister implication based on the religious framework that's there? Is there an element, could there eventually become an element of coercion for it? I'm just reflecting, where do numbers, where does the success, the quantification play in the practice?
I have just a quick question, which I think also has to do with the embeddedness of this practice in sort of larger context. Since you start your paper by talking about how religion, Orthodox religion mainly plays this prohibitive role vis-a-vis post-mortem donation, I'm interested in whether this organization, which focuses on living donation, has any kind of an explicit or implicit position vis-a-vis that. For example, you could see how this living donation could be viewed as a substitute for the need for post-mortem donation. And therefore some of the good that it's doing in a way is offset by the way in which it kind of supports or fails to question a larger prohibitive role by religion. Or you could see these individuals trying to push back against the kind of ultra-Orthodox concerns about time of death and prohibitions and saying, you know, religion in general needs to play a more facilitative role rather than a blocking role to facilitate not only living but post-mortem donation. So I don't know if they've said anything about this, but that would be interesting to know.
Okay. I think I wanted also to
refer to the points made here.
I mean, there's discussion in halakha, Jewish law, in late Middle Ages. There's the supreme value of redemption of the captives. And the halakha says you would sell a scroll of Torah for this sake, but not a synagogue. And the explanation given is this is the way of the world, this is not the way of the world. So it's not exactly the divine order. Nobody, the halakha doesn't say one is more sacred or protected than the other. There is another social order here to be explored about boundaries. And this organ donation group really transgresses here in a way, creates a new realm. But if we reflect on these historical archetypal sacrifices, that it made sense for Abraham to go and sacrifice Isaac and not to be sent on a suicide sacrifice. And then for Jesus to submit himself to death and not to go and sacrifice Mary. So it's not just that we're willing to give everything for God. There's another set of boundaries in our social cultural orders that is not clearly a divine order, but belong to a certain kind of other order. And also plays a role why people don't donate a kidney, even though it's nothing.
Yes, okay.
Thank you. There were some few interpretive comments that I have to think about it and see how, if it all fits into the data and to the story of Matnat Chaim. And there were some specific questions that I will shortly answer regarding the organization's point of view concerning brain death. Actually, it is interesting to see how it is not on the table. And again, this is another indicator of playing now the card of we are private. We do not have to answer ethical, big ethical questions about organ donations. We are making our milut chasadim.
Charity.
We are doing our little charity thing here and not, dealing with these big controversial questions. I'm taking totally the Durkheim approach that Chaim suggested. I forgot... the numbers.
Where does
quantification fit in creative altruism? Yes. Well, no. Nothing could be. Altruism is hard to quantify and say, okay, this is another instance of altruistic behavior. You could never know in living donations what are the interior motives, the social dynamics, you can guess and interpret it on basis of from the sociological point of view, from gender relations, from different class maybe statuses, but it is a big and ethical question in transplantation: is the donation really altruistic or not? So this concludes, and now I will have the other hat of the of the conference organizer, and I'm inviting you all to lunch down. Yes, it's 12. Yes. Okay. Down here at the cafeteria, Shai will lead the way.
Follow me. And thank you.
Yes.
We can leave them.
כן.